العلم أشراف مطلب وطالبه لله أكرام من يمشي على قدم. العلم نور مبين يستضيء به أهل السعادات والجهال في الظلم.
الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه، أما بعد، in the beginning we have to know the position of the scholars of the Ummah amongst the people. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned that in the Quran. Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءِ. Indeed, those who fear Allah the most are those people of knowledge, the scholars. And as we all know that the scholars are the inheritors of the prophets, as in the hadith, al-ulama warathatul anbiya, al-ulama warathat الأنبياء. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said that the scholars are the inheritors of the prophets. Inheritors of the prophets. And the prophets did not leave as inheritance behind them but knowledge, but the knowledge. But the knowledge. So he who ever takes as much as he can from this knowledge, then he is the one who took the best share of inheritance of the prophets. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informed us as well in the Quran that he, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he wants to take away any of part of the knowledge, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not extract it from the chest of the scholars. But he, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, takes the storage of the knowledge, the scholars, and when he, Allah ta'ala, take the scholar, he will take the knowledge that he, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, has put on earth. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informed us that the ulama are the security for people in this world. Security for the people in this world. Because their remaining on earth keeps Allah pleased, because they are going to worship Allah and they are going to teach the people what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed, and their gatherings are the gatherings where Allah and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned or remembered the most. And that's why Allah ta'ala is pleased with them and with those who are in these gatherings. And as he, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, informed us that He told us, he said, subhanahu wa ta'ala, as in Surah Al-Ra'd, ayah 41, أَوَلَمْ يَرَوْا أَنَّا نَأْتِ الْأَرْضَ نَنْقُصُهَا مِنْ أَطْرَافِهَا. Have they not seen that we come to the earth and we shorten it from the edges of it? If it is left to us to understand, we are going to think that the earth is going shrinking little until no space is left. But that is not the thing wanted. Look to the people of knowledge, how do they understand the ayat? Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma said about this ayah, he said, it is the destruction of the earth by the death of the scholars. Because when the scholars die, then the people of ignorance appear. As in the hadith, Allah, as in the hadith, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that he Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, "Inna Allah la yaqbidu al-ilm intiza'an intiza'u min sudur rijal, walakin yaqbidu al-ilm biqabd al-ulama." Allah does not take the knowledge, extracting it from the chest of the men, but Allah takes the knowledge by taking the ulama. Hatta idha lam yabqa 'alim aw yubqi 'aliman, up until Allah leaves no single 'alim on earth. اتخذ الناس رؤوسا جهالا. They, the people, will take leaders who are ignorant, leaders in knowledge, not leaders in ruling, but in knowledge, leaders as scholars. But these leaders are ignorant; they are not scholars in reality. They are fake. As some of the scholars said, that most of the people speak today about knowledge are Google graduates. What does that mean? He said that once the electricity goes off, their knowledge evaporates. If you ask them, when there is no internet or no electricity, they tell you, "You please wait until the light comes back." Why? So that, because they don't have knowledge. They don't have knowledge. And the ulama said, in the elderly ulama, in the past, the ancient ulama said, "Al-ilmu ma hawahu sadru, la ma hawahu al-qimatru." Qimatru means, he said, the knowledge is what the chest contained, not the papers, not the book, not the notebook. Now, yes, it is important to keep knowledge in books, because you're going to die and the people after you read what you wrote, what you left. But the alim, who is real alim, must have the knowledge in his chest. Well, as Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah said, "What would my enemies do by putting me in prison? It's for me a kind of khalwa," meaning being alone, so I worship Allah and review my books. And he compiled some books in the prison. And he said, and if they depart me, if they depart me from the land, then for me it is siyaha. Siyaha means tourism, but he means the religious tourism, meaning he's going to convey his message to the lands that they are going to deport him to. Subhanallah. Look to the people, look to the ulama, how they think. They don't think about settling and having big houses and having big cars. La. They don't look for dunya. Yeah. And I'm going to tell you about my Shaykh Mohamed Adam. Wallah ya ikhwa. Not only him, I saw a number of shuyukh. Subhanallah, the dunya came to their hands, but they don't look for it. They don't look for it. Subhanallah. They threw it away. And they prefer to stay just with little of what make them continue in life. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informed us about that. About the rank of the ulama, which should be amongst the people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he took witnesses for his oneness, he took from human only ulama. Allah ta'ala said, shahid Allahu annahu la ilaha illa huwa wal malaikatu wa ulul ilm. Allah witnessed that there is no one worthy of worship but he, Allah alone. And the angels. The angels also witnessed that. Okay, the angels means all the angels. Right, when he talked about mankind, he said, wa ulul ilm, only the people of knowledge who witnessed Allah, Allah's oneness. But who is these people of knowledge? Not people who have information. Because the knowledge is what you do, what you act. You act. Knowledge must be transgressed to your actions. Your actions. What you do. What you do. As Allah Ta'ala said, وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَيُعَلِّمُكُمُ اللَّهَ and fear Allah and Allah will teach you knowledge. Will teach you knowledge. So this is about the ulama, and from these ulama of whom I met and I benefited and studied with, alhamdulillah, Allah blessed me by sitting to all the kibar, except for some like Sheikh Al-Amin Al-Shinqiti, Sheikh Abdul Razzaq Hamza, Sheikh Abdul Razzaq Afifi. I did not meet them. They died early. But I met, alhamdulillah, most of the, I studied with Sheikh Bin Baz, studied with Sheikh Al-Uthaymeen, studied with Sheikh Abdul Ghudayyan, Sheikh Salah Fozan, Sheikh Abdul Muhsin Al-Abbas, Sheikh Omar Fallata, Sheikh Muhammad Abdullah Somali, Sheikh Muhammad Al-Tayyib Al-Shinqiti, and Sheikh محمد المختار الشنقيطي شيخ محمد عبد الوهاب البنا and I met شيخ الباني sat to him الحمد لله sat in one talk in our masjid in Jeddah and in another talk in another masjid next to ours in Jeddah and then we had dinner together and we learned in that subhanallah when you sit to the ulama you learn not necessarily in the class but you just be with the ulama you learn a lot. Yani, I remember now just something came to my mind. When Sheikh Albani, rahimahullah, came in for Hajj in year 1410, he gave a lecture in our masjid. Then we had him in a dinner, private dinner. So Sheikh did not use to sit on the ground because of his knees. Yani, it hurts him. It hurt him. So we made him sit on a chair and bought a table, but we sat on the ground around the table. Then they brought the plate. The custom here in Saudi Arabia is to serve the food in big plate that six or seven can sit around. And usually we eat with our hands. So the Sheikh sat and he was waiting. Then we said, "Ya Sheikh, let's eat." He said, "No spoon?" We said, "Ya Sheikh, spoon, sunnah is with hand." He said, "Sunnah is with hand. You know sunnah? You know, you guys know sunnah? You eat like this? You fill all your palm and you eat big, you know, at once?" He said, "Sunnah is to take like this, which the spoon closer to sunnah than what you do." Subhanallah, we learn. We learn something. So whenever you go with the scholars, you learn. You learn something, subhanallah. So, Sheikh, I met Sheikh Muqbil and I learned, subhanallah. And I will speak about this when I come to the part related to Sunan Nasa'i of Sheikh Muhammad Adam. I will delay it until then. But believe me, ikhwa, when you sit to the scholars, let me tell you what it is like. It is like someone goes to a very nice place, nice garden, nice scenery, river, green, good weather, yani different birds yani tweeting, and you see butterflies here and there, you see very beautiful. Okay, he saw it and he described it to you. How is the feeling between you and him? Big difference. You still feel good to hear about this, but it's not like when you go and see it and live in it and feel it and, you know, enjoy it. Exactly like that when you hear of the ulama. Wallahi, sitting to them is totally different than what you hear about them. Totally, completely different. Completely different. What you hear is, let me consider it, 0.1%. Not 1%, 0.1%. Look at that. What, wallahi ya ikhwa, you learn from their way of looking. And that's why Imam Malik, rahimahullah ta'ala, when he was a little boy, his mother, because he was orphan, his father passed away early. So his mother dressed him well and took him to the masjid of the Prophet ﷺ, where the muhaddith of the masjid, Rabi' ibn Abdul Rahman, who is known by Rabi'at al-Ra'i, was sitting, giving the students the yani, knowledge. She said to her son, "My son, go to this man and learn from him. And let first thing you learn from him be his manners and his etiquettes and way of talking." And, you know, these things, you cannot take it from the books. These things, you take it from sitting to the scholars. And that's why, and sticking long time, it's not, yani many people, they go and see a sheikh, sit with him, yani a couple of days a week, and then come back and say, "Oh, I studied with sheikh so-and-so." Nah, it's not like that. It's not like that. Look to, for example, Thabit ibn Aslam al-Bunani. He sat to Anas ibn Malik, he sat to him 40 years seeking knowledge. 40, 40. Is there any student in this world today who study for 40 years? Yani, if he goes to the college, study 2 years in the Arabic Institute, and then 4 years in the college, he returns Imam. They call him Imam so-and-so, Imam so-and-so. And he starts talking about the major issues in the dunya. You know, subhanallah. Drop this alim, raise this little student, drop this ruler, drop this country, do this, subhanallah. While you see a alim who spent years and years and ages in seeking knowledge and teaching it, and in the library all the day, all the night, and he never ever interferes into these issues. And for example, Sheikh Abbad many times was asked about talaq, and he says, "You go and ask the mufti." No fatwa of talaq here, fatwa with the mufti. And many times they ask him about even some yani knowledge about hadith, and he says, "Allahu a'lam, Allahu a'lam." Maybe that time he doesn't remember, or maybe he wanted to give a listen to the students to say Allahu A'lam, to say Allahu A'lam. To say Allahu A'lam. So what I mean to say is, sitting to the scholars is great thing, ya ikhwan. Very, very great thing. It's not something small, something you can earn from the books. La, you have to sit to a scholar. You have to sit to a scholar. And every place where you are now, whoever listening to me now is watching me, wherever you are, if there is an alim or a student of knowledge who studied under ulama, graduated, please don't abandon his sittings and circles and go here and there. Nah, go to him and sit to him and learn from him. I remember when me, Sheikh Abdussalam al-Suhaimi, and Sheikh Muqbil al-Harbi were in England, we were in Wales for a conference, and then we returned back to Birmingham, and I suggested to the Sheikh, we visit Sheikh Hassan Rashid. He is one of the first graduates from Medina University. The first group, along with Sheikh Wasiullah and many others. And he studied with Sheikh Abdul Mahsin Abbad in Al-Azhar, his master's. So we went, three of us, to see Sheikh Hassan Rashid in his house. And they both were amazed. I visited them a number of times whenever I go to England. And I always tell the brothers, Ya Ikhwa, this is wrong. You have an alim like this, and you abandon him, leave him. Allah brought him for you from Medina to make his qadr to live here. How come no one come and sit to him and learn from him? He is very knowledgeable, in especially in the field of hadith and Arabic language and many other fields. This is our problem today. This is our problem. We don't know the alim until he died. Now, when Hassan Rashid died, you guys in the West will blame yourself only. Because Allah brought you someone, and subhanAllah, he's from Pakistan or India, I forgot, he's Pakistan, I think. And he was, he studied in Medina. Then he went to Egypt to get his master's. Then he was, Allah Ta'ala decreed that he be in England. Where are the students of knowledge? Even the graduates, they should go to him. He is at least 30 years pre to those who graduated, or 40 years. So how come the knowledge is this is very important, ya ikhwa. Wallahi, it is very great. If you see the ulama, how they deal with each other, for example, one time I drove Sheikh Mohamed Aman al-Jami, rahimahullah, in my car from Jeddah to Mecca, and there were some other students with us in the car. The Sheikh was next to me, and I was driving my car. And when we reached Aziziya, where the house of Sheikh Ibn Baz there, where his masjid now, that time the masjid wasn't there. So we entered, and he has a big hall where many people sitting. Sheikh Mohamed Aman was in front of us, and he stood. He was very tall, and Sheikh Ibn Baz was short. So Sheikh Mohamed Aman stopped by the gate, and he said, "Assalamu alaykum wa rahmat." His voice is well known. Sheikh Ibn Baz, many years he didn't see Muhammad Aman. But he knows him very well because he is his Sheikh. Muhammad Aman used to study with Sheikh Ibn Baz. When Sheikh Ibn Baz was the deputy and then the director of Islamic University, he was with him, working with him. So Sheikh Ibn Baz stood up and he said, "Man, Muhammad Aman Ibn Ali, wallahi ya ikhwa," like that. And he hugged him, and subhanAllah, how they love each other, how they respect each other, how they, like that. So I mean to say, ikhwa, it's a good chance now. Yes, today, you all knew that I studied under Muhammad Adam. No one asked about it. Now the Sheikh died. Yes, it's good to speak about him, but it was better to know about him or know him or know from him. Naam? The knowledge and like these things. Anyway, Sheikh Muhammad rahimahullah ta'ala was born in year 1366 of the Hijra calendar. 1366 of the Hijra calendar. And he was born in Ethiopia. And he studied under his father, who was the mufti of their region at that time. But his father was like everyone else, Hanafi, Abu Hanafi Madhab, and they were Ash'ari on Aqidah, as you're going to hear. So Sheikh studied with his father, Quran, and Hanafi Madhab and like that. And then he studied with another scholar called Muhammad Qiyu ibn Wuddi and Muhammad Sa'id ibn Sheikh Ali al-Dirri, Sheikh, the very big scholar in Arabic grammar, Nahu. They used to call him Siba Way of his time. Sheikh Abdul Basit ibn Muhammad ibn Hassan, al-Ethiopi, al-Borni, al-Minasi. And Sheikh Hayat ibn Ali al-Ethiopi al-Darri, Sheikh Muhammad Zain ibn Muhammad Yasin al-Dani, Sheikh the Muhaddith of the land of Habasha, of Ethiopia in his time, Sheikh Muhammad ibn Rafi' Basiri, Sheikh Muhammad Thani ibn Habib al-Ethiopi, Sheikh Ali Jammi al-Lajhadi al-Ethiopi, Sheikh Muhammad Arab al-Ajamisi al-Ethiopi, Sheikh the Mufassir, scholar of Tafsir, Abdul Jalil, the son of Sheikh Ali al-Baridi, Sheikh Faqih Hassan Tawalliya, Sheikh Siraj al-Bajmadri, Sheikh Umar ibn Ali ibn Bushra al-Tibbi, and Sheikh Ahmad al-Din Shafi'i. He was very big scholar in the Fiqh al-Shafi'i, and he talked from him, Fiqh al-Shafi'i. He studied also under somebody who he called him my brother, Siraj Muhammad al-Jami al-Shafi'i. He's from the same family of Sheikh Muhammad Aman, rahimahumullah. And Sheikh Idris Qayyu, Sheikh Ali Adam al-Yasali, he studied them the Arabic language, and Sheikh Muhammad Jibril, Sheikh Yusuf al-Sisi, Sheikh Muhammad Wali ibn Sheikh Ahmed ibn Umar al-Darri, and he studied with some sheikh from also Yemen, such as Muhammad Siraj ibn Salih al-Rayawi, ثم اليمني ثم المكي, who settled in Yemen first. He's not Yemeni, but he lived in Yemen. He went to Yemen, studied, and then he went to Mecca. He's from Ethiopia as well. And Sheikh Muhammad Nur ibn Sheikh Idris al-Yajawi, Sheikh Ahmed al-Hadi al-Warrawi, Sheikh Muhammad Nur al-Dani, Sheikh Muhammad Ahmed ibn Muhammad al-Ifati, Sheikh Ahmed al-Tawil, Muhammad Awal al-Wurraji, and from Yemen, Sheikh Ismail ibn Uthman Zain al-Yemeni, also Sheikh Muhammad Yasin ibn Muhammad Isa al-Fadani al-Makki, Sheikh Muhammad al-Muntasir al-Kattani, Sheikh Muhammad Abdullah al-Somali, and this Sheikh, subhanAllah, I met him and I studied with him some parts of Sahih Muslim. He was laying on his bed. He was the Muhaddith of Mecca. He was very, very great scholar. Very great scholar. Somali, very big scholar. Sheikh from Somalia originally, but for he was given the Saudi nationality at that time, rahimahullah. He was very top in manners, in memory, in fiqh, and in hadith. He was the muhaddith of Mecca, Sheikh Muhammad Abdullah al-Somali. Our sheikh studied with him. He sat with him, but Sheikh Muhammad Adam was already big, big sheikh. This was very recent, in year 1419. It's not that far, he studied with him, and he gave him ijaza. He gave him ijaza as he said. And also he studied with the Moroccan yani major scholar of hadith, but he is in Aqidah. He wasn't yani on the Salafi Aqidah, but he was in hadith. He was well known, Muhammad Siddiq al-Ghimari. Abdullah ibn Muhammad Siddiq al-Ghimari. Sheikh Albani said he's better than his other brother, the other Ghimari in Aqidah. Naam. Sheikh Abu Bakr Zuhair ibn Mustafa al-Dimashqi from Syria, he sent him ijazah to from Syria to him in Mecca. Also from India, from Arakan, from Burma, Mawlawi, Sheikh Mawlawi Azaz al-Haq, Ibn Mawlawi Mudhir al-Haq. He also sent him ijazah. And he said, after I studied with all, these are not all of them. The Sheikh gave me his isnad with his book, Thabat. It's yani full of shuyukh. Yani he studied and he met, and he has ijazat from nearly 1,000 scholars. That's why you see the Sheikh is a big library. When you sit to the Sheikh, when you read his books, all those scholars who read his books, they were yani amazed to how this man, yani Sheikh Muqbil said that yani he's like Ibn Hajar. His book Sunan Nasa'i is exactly like Fath al-Bari, subhanallah. And he had all this in his memory. It's not only memorizing like a CD and you save in it, with understanding, with subhanallah. Even Sheikh Muqbil praised his understanding, subhanallah. And and then he wanted to when the communist took over the ruling in Ethiopia, they started causing troubles and tortures to the religious people. So the Sheikh was young and he wanted to escape, so to save himself and his religion. But he couldn't find a way. They give some permissions for some people to go for Umrah, but only old people who are over 50 or something. And he was young. So him and one of his colleagues, they applied, and he was, alhamdulillah, accepted, but his colleague wasn't accepted. He came to Mecca in year 1401 of the Hijra calendar. And first thing he did when he came, his students, his people who know how much knowledge he has, they tried to find him a school or an institute to teach in. But the problem, in this advanced schooling, they ask for certificates like a degree. But he said to them, I have no degree, but I have knowledge. They said, we cannot hire you as a teacher. And he wanted to stay in Mecca. So he has to find something, otherwise he will be deported. So he, rahimahullah, was advised to go and apply in Ma'ad al-Haram. He applied in some other places, but he wasn't accepted. When he applied in Ma'ad al-Haram, in Masjid al-Haram, there is an institute there called the Institute of the Masjid al-Haram. He applied and he was accepted. And I remember from what he said to us, he said, they put me with the little kids, and I was a big alim. He was true. When he came, he was a big alim. He said, I used to carry bag with books in it, like the small kids. And the kids, they laugh at me when I come like that. He said, but I want to stay. What can I do? Without this, I can't stay. And he, at that time, used to sit to some ulama and used to read some books that were banned in his land when he was there. such as the books of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, Shaykh al-Islam ibn Qayyim, and Shaykh al-Islam Muhammad Abdul Wahab. He said, we did not used to know these books. Because, you know, the Ash'aris, and they don't allow these books to yani be in their lands and in the hands of the students. So the Shaykh said that he remained there until he finished the high school. So nearly 6 or 9 years. And then he went to Dar al-Hadith. Dar al-Hadith had a director there called Ali ibn Amir, rahimahullah, who used to respect people of knowledge. First, the Sheikh went there to apply as a student in the baccalaureate level. And they used to make a committee for interviewing any applicant. So when he came, the committee were some scholars, and they, when they asked him, they saw that this man is not a student, this man is a great alim. They went to the director Ali ibn Amr, and they told him that this man cannot be a student. This must be hired as a sheikh, as an alim. Sheikh Ali ibn Amr saw him, and he asked, and he told him that I don't have except this shahada, this certificate from Ma'ad al-Haram, which is only high school. He said, Sheikh Ali ibn Amr, rahimahullah, said to him, we don't care about certificates or degrees. We care about knowledge. Because they care about knowledge. How many doctors today who don't have even a drop of the knowledge of Sheikh Muhammad Adam? You know, subhanallah. So, Sheikh Ali ibn Amir raised a letter to the president of the Dar al-Hadith, which was the Mufti, Sheikh Abdul Aziz ibn Abdullah ibn Baz. And no one on earth at that time know and estimate properly the scholars like Sheikh ibn Baz. He used to respect the scholars, love them. He's the one who brought Muhammad al-Amin al-Jakni to the Jama'ah Islamiyah. He's the one who brought Sheikh Nasruddin al-Albani and all those great scholars, him, Abdul Aziz ibn Baz, rahimahullah, is the one who brought them and hired them there. So Sheikh ibn Baz immediately agreed, and he said, this is a scholar. He must be assigned as a teacher in Dar al-Hadith. And he was teaching in the below the baccalaureate. But just a while later, when they said that he must be in the degrees, he teach the people who in the degree, like baccalaureate. So the Sheikh continued there. And subhanAllah, the Sheikh never wished to stop. And never, he went only one time to Ethiopia to see his father. And when they saw him, and talked to him about his life and his knowledge and that, they noticed that he changed from Ash'ariyya. They told him, the scholars there, they told him, you became Wahhabi? He said, no, but I followed the Dalil. And I found the books of Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah ibn Qayyim and Muhammad al-Wahhab only contain Dalil. And you knew me from before that I only take the Dalil. He said, yeah, we knew you. You were extreme, and now you'll be more extreme. He said, no. I only, and then he reminded them of Shafi'i. He said, you remember Shafi'i when he was in Al-Hijaz in Iraq? He had his madhab. And then when he went to Egypt and found lots of evidences, he had a new madhab. Because the person must prepare himself to follow the Dalil, not what the people say. La, the Dalil. إِذَا جَاءَ نَارُ اللَّهِ بَطَلَ نَارَ مَعْقِلَ. This statement I had it from Sheikh Muhammad Adam himself. He always repeat that to our ears. إِذَا جَاءَ نَارُ اللَّهِ, when the river of Allah comes, نَارُ مَعْقِلَ بَطَلَ نَارُ مَعْقِلَ. The river of Ma'qil is cancelled. What does that mean? Ma'qil used to have water, river, and he used to sell the water. So people used to pay. But when it rains heavily and the river runs, they don't go there. خلاص, water is free there. Why would we go to Maqam? Same thing. When the Dalil comes, don't go to any others. As Imam Malik said, كُلٌّ يُؤْخَذْ مِنْ قَوْلِهِ وَيُرَدْ إِلَّا صَاحِبَ هَذَا الْقَبْرِ. Anyway, Sheikh Adam continued in Dar al-Hadith. I came to know about him in year 1411, yani 10 years after he came to Mecca. And I was that time living in Jeddah. I was young though. I used to study in Jeddah with some scholars like Safar al-Hawari and this. But when I knew what Safar al-Halali is, Hawari Ab'un, and he, I used to be close to him. I have a written hand, scripture written, tazkiyah from him. But when I found that he is wrong, I fornicated him, but he didn't accept. So I said, khalas, I left. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I left that for the sake of Allah subhanallah. I left that sitting for the sake of Allah. Allah opened for me something so huge gate when I came to the Dars of Sheikh Adam. Someone, I don't know him. Someone, I didn't used to go to Mecca for seeking knowledge. I used to study with Sheikh Muhammad Abdul Rahab al-Banna, Rahim Allah, who was in Jeddah. I used to study with him. I studied with Muhammad al-Mukhtar. Naam. But, and these are the two who were available in Jeddah at that time. But when I heard about Sheikh Muhammad Adam, I started going. I used to go 6 days a week for 17 years, from Friday until Wednesday. Thursday, the Sheikh stops for kind of day off. And his day off is not to go picnic or nah, his day off is only to sit in the house and write, continue writing, continue reading. So Sheikh Adam continued to teach in Dar al-Hadith as a teacher in the morning. And in the evening, he used to come back to Dar al-Hadith, to the masjid, to the mosque. It was a small mosque inside Dar al-Hadith for the people to pray. Students used to live there. And during the time of schooling, they used to come and pray there. But he used to teach between Maghrib and Isha and after Isha 1 hour. When I came first, I didn't understand anything of what he says. Sheikh was very fast in speaking, and he used to speak proper Arabic. We are not accustomed to this, So, but by the time, alhamdulillah, the students, the number of the students that time was small, and that was, alhamdulillah, good for us, because the Sheikh used to know every one of us. And he used to, he had a habit. Once he comes and sit on the chair, he used to not to start his lesson until he hears from every one of us. Those who are ready to read from memory, the biography of five men of the Sahihain, Sahih Bukhari and Muslim, from his book, Talkhisu. قرة العين بتلخيصه تراجم رجال الصحيحين. We used to every day, it's not that big. The Sheikh memorized it to two lines or three lines maximum. But five of them with the, their dates of birth, dates of this, all about them. And on Friday, we used to study ألفية السيوطي in مصطلح. And he used to make us memorize five lines every time. And on Wednesday, Al-Fiyat ibn Malik, and used also in the grammar of Arabic language, used to make us also memorize and read from memory five lines. And like that. And he used to correct everyone who make mistake. And he used to make someone read for him, not like now he reads. Now, before he died, in the last maybe 20 years or 15 years, he started reading himself. But before La, when we began with him, he used to make someone read for him. And subhanAllah, he always commit correct and like that. Alhamdulillah, I traveled with the Shaykh and I, subhanAllah, and he had good lessons from this travel. I traveled with him to Riyadh. But before that, when the Shaykh was preparing his book, Sunan Nasa'i, for printing, he used to type it his own on a typewriter, not a computer at that time, a typewriter. He used to type it, for preparing it for printing. And there the printers, they re-type it again, but he used to type it. And he used to give it to us like this. And we used to go through and check and correct. And I will show you something of what we... This is from the books that we corrected with the Sheikh. We used to take it, who correct, and then return it back to him, and he write it in his own copy. Like this here, for example, if you can see it, you can see this here, where my finger is. There is a word which is as a mistake in the typing. It says, Fasumi'a, Fasumi'a. Yani there is a wow extra. Then we corrected Fasumi'a. And here, for example, it says, here where my finger is, I don't know if you see it, it says Al-Mulk. And it is Al-Milla, not Al-Mulk. La yukhriju an Al-Milla. It says La yukhriju an Al-Mulk. And like that, we used to go with the Sheikh and correct the mistakes before sending it to the printer or to the publishers. Learned a lot by that. First thing I learned is that he used to do everything his own. He used to have a small library, but his library is here. All books here. He used to have a small library in his house. And he used to have a little cotton mattress. He stays in the library more than inside the house. And he does not allow any visitors, anybody come. Very rare and very short time and like this. We used to come when we used to review this. And he, by that time, there were some companies produced programs of hadith, how to search and, like that. There is a program called Al-Mawsu' Al-Hadithiyya that time. And it used to be in a big device like this hard disk, and with cable, you plug it in and, it's only for that hadith, hadith. So we suggested to the Sheikh, he said, he doesn't have computer, doesn't know. Yani computer was brought to him, and then we used to go there and teach him how to use the computer, how to use this. Ya ikhwa, wallahi, so clever. In a short while, he knew how. I bought the same program. Wallahi, until the internet started uploading these libraries on it, until that time, I did not know how to operate that program which I bought. And I bought it expensive that time. But I didn't benefit from it. Why? Because I'm not that clever, not like the Sheikh. The Sheikh just few sittings with the brother, the technician, mashallah, he became very fluent in it. And he started typing everything. I want to show you two books, which is still scratcher. This one, see how big this one? And see how big this one. This is small, this is big. This is this. But how? This was on the old way, the typewriter. He used to type only one side. He cannot type the other side because it's difficult, on the typewriter. But this one, when he learned about computer, he started typing on both sides. See, subhanAllah, this all, in typing. Sheikh, rahimahullah ta'ala, used not to eat a lot. very little. Whatever food can yani give him strength, that's it. He doesn't eat much. And he doesn't care about what is the food, what is. And I remember in Hajj, when we had Hajj a couple of times, first Hajj in year 14-13, 2 years after I came to New York, we went Hajj together. It was a big gathering in a Hajj group called Al-Imam al-Bukhari. And there were a number of the Shaykh, Sheikh Ali Hassan al-Halabi, Sheikh Salim al-Hilali, as I remember, Mashur, I forgot Mashur was with them or not, Mustafa al-Adawi. And mashallah, it was a big gathering. But the Sheikh did not even talk to anybody. He has his books and he has the Quran. He reviews his books and read the Quran. That's it. He doesn't talk. He doesn't sit to the people. Yani they even asked him to give some talks. He did not agree. I gave some talks, although I'm poor in knowledge. But we have to fill the gap. And the Sheikh didn't want, but he was the reference in fatawa and like that. So the Sheikh Hafidha Rahimahullah used to really be a treasure. A treasure by meaning of treasure. A treasure of knowledge, whatever field of knowledge. He wrote in every field, as we are gonna see, in every field of knowledge. He wrote in Hadith, he wrote in the Rijal, the chain of narration. He wrote in the Arabic with different fields of Arabic language. The grammar, the word study, the poetry, the poems. He wrote in Tafsir, he wrote in Aqidah, he wrote in Usul al-Fiqh, in Fiqh, in every field. And even he wrote poetry to refute others, as we are going to see. The Sheikh was so, I remember when I used to give his book, Sunan Nasa'i, when it was only 12 values published that time. I bought a number of them and used to put them in box and put a letter on it to each scholar to introduce the Sheikh to the scholars. That time, still, people did not know much about it. And from those people, I remember we had a meeting with the Mufti in Mecca. We, the du'at of the Jaliyat, the minorities. The minorities, we have da'wah centers for minorities, especially non-Muslims. So we had meeting with him. And I said, it's a good chance now to introduce the Sheikh to the Mufti. I came, it was on Sunday after Isha. I came with the books and I said to the Mufti, this is a gift. This is the book of my Sheikh, a gift for you. He said, who is this Sheikh? I said, so-and-so. He didn't know him first. He didn't recognize him because the Sheikh is in Riyadh all the time. But guess what? This was on Sunday. On Wednesday, Sheikh Mohammed Adam after Isha called me. And he was very happy, very, very happy. And he said, look, the Mufti called, the office of the Mufti called today Darul Hadith, and they said, tell Muhammad Adam to come, tell Sheikh Muhammad Adam to come to the office of the Mufti now because the Mufti is leaving today and he wants to see him. He said, I went, I don't know what he wants from me. He said, I went there and he received me very greatly, respectfully, and he made me sit and served me. And then he recited the introduction of my book from his memory, nearly 20 pages, something like that. Subhanallah. And he said to me, he has good memory. Subhanallah. So after that, the Sheikh told me that he wants to go to Riyadh to see the Mufti. So I went to Mecca, got him, came back to Jeddah, to my house. We slept, so next day we are traveling to Riyadh. When Fajr came, I woke up the Sheikh, we performed wudu, went to the masjid. When I came to the masjid, prayed to rak'at, he prayed to rak'at, he laid down. He laid down. Why? And people were looking. What's this man doing? Why is he laying down? Is he sleeping between Adhan and Iqamah? But he wasn't sleeping. He was implementing his sunnah. This is a lesson. Whenever you know a sunnah, try to do it. Don't care about people, what they say. Do the sunnah. It doesn't harm anybody. Huh? Today, people ask, don't accept me wearing my beard. Can I trim it? Can I shave it? Can I this? Can I this? Subhanallah. The sheikh did this. Then I told the sheikh after we were going to Riyadh on the plane. And the sheikh said that this is sunnah, and he gave me the hadith where Aisha radiallahu anha said that Rasulullah used to pray the two rak'ah and sleep until he blew, blew air. That's sunnah. And I remember we went to Riyadh, and it was a very beautiful meeting with the Mufti in his masjid. And then returned. And after a while, we traveled to Taif twice to see the Mufti. I remember one of these two times when we came, it was right after finishing Salat al-Asr. We already prayed on the way. We came to the house of the Mufti, and they finished Salat al-Asr. He was coming with his guide with him, because the Mufti is blind. So the guide was holding him and bringing him. So I started giving salam. Salamu alaikum, Shaykhana. Ana Muhammad al-Maliki, ma'a Shaykh Mohamed Adam. MashaAllah, welcome, welcome. He let us in to his villa. His villa has a yard. They already poured water to cool it down, and the smell was very nice because of the soil. And there was carpet put on it. So the sheikh sat and he told his guy, go and bring the books. He brought this big pile of books, many different field of knowledge. That's the habit of the Mufti. They read for him, and he, subhanAllah, listen. And he makes some ta'liqat or comments. From these things that I remember still until today, maybe now 20 something years, I still remember it. He mentioned hadith reported by Anas, from Anas. And then he started speaking about Anas, and he said that Anas had 150 of his own children and grandchildren like that. And then he said, and he laughed, he said, these are the men, these are the men, meaning that they have many children. Not like us today, 1, 2, 3, and that's it, 4, that's it. Then Sheikh Adam also laughed, and Sheikh, they were talking about this. It was really beautiful, really beautiful. I cannot tell you every single detail that we had, but it was really beautiful. And when Sheikh Muqbil was in Jeddah for treatment in King Faisal Hospital, I told the Sheikh, what do you think if we go and visit Sheikh Muqbil? He said, I would love that, I would love that. I called Sheikh Dr. Ali bin Ghazi Tuwajri, Hafizahullah, from Medina, and he came. And we met in my house. We had the lunch together, prayed Asr, and went direct to the hospital. Found the Sheikh in the yard outside of the hospital. There is a garden, and he had the rug for him. He was sitting, and his own students and relatives were just a little bit far from him, not very far, but just a little bit. So we came and I gave salam, Sheikh, salamu alaikum. I am Muhammad al-Maliki, this is Sheikh Muhammad Adam, this is Sheikh Dr. Ali Tuwajri. He welcomed us. He didn't know any of us. He didn't recognize any of us. Although I met him with Sheikh Muhammad al-Banna in the hotel called Al-Hamra Sofitel in Palestine Road. I came there with Sheikh Muhammad al-Banna, and we met him. So when I said to him that, I said, Sheikh, here is Sheikh Muhammad Adam. We want you to write something for his book. He said, what book? I said, The Explanation of Sunan Nisa. He said, I don't know the book. I don't know the author. I said, well, the book is here. It's only already 12 values published. And the author is here. He said, okay, leave me with him for a while. So me and Sheikh Ali Tuhajiri went aside and they started talking about hadith, about rijal, about this. Then the Sheikh called us, Sheikh Muqbil. We came. He said, look, leave the book with us. Leave your number. And we are going to call you when ready. A few days later, I was driving to Mecca to attend the dars of Sheikh Adam when they called me just by leaving Jeddah. Not yet finished districts of Jeddah, last district of Jeddah, I received a call. Someone from the surrounders of Sheikh Muqbil, he said, you're Muhammad al-Maliki? I said, yes. He said, the Sheikh wants you to come right now. I immediately returned, and I stopped by stationery, and I bought the yellow band, which is B4 size, and I went to the Sheikh. The Sheikh said to me, before he say anything, when I entered, then two men asked permission to visit the Sheikh. They entered. Sheikh asked him, where are you from? Medina. What do you do? He said, teachers. He said, okay. Al-Madina tu khayrun lahum law kanu ya'lamun. Who is the narrator of this hadith and who is the reporter of this hadith, meaning the like Bukhari and Muslim? They kept silent. And then he said to them, this is the hadith of Sufyan and this. Then they left. When they left, he said to me, أَرَدْنَا أَن نَكْتُبَ شَيْئًا فَلَمْ نَجِدْ أَحَدًا خَطُّ جَمِيلٍ. Said, we wanted to write something, but I didn't find anyone whose writing is nice. I said, Sheikh, try me. He said, Yani, you writing, your writing is nice? I said, I can't praise my own writing. Said, okay. And then he dictated something. One full page, I used to write one line and drop one. And when he finished almost one page, he said, stop, I am getting tired. We continue next time. Show me. I showed him. He said, Khattun Jameel. I said, this is a great witnessing or a great recommendation that I will put on my chest. So I left. A couple of days later, they called, said, Sheikh wants you. I came. And again, he dictated the rest of the speech of what he wanted to say. And he said many, many very beautiful things on that, book. Let me just drop the book and maybe read for you something of what the Sheikh said. I have the old edition, which doesn't have the Sheikh introduction. This one, the old one, which was published in year 1416. It doesn't have the recommendation of Sheikh Muqbil, but this one, which is published in 1425, has the Sheikh Muqbil's introduction here, as you see it. And I was the one who wrote it, and I had written this here, how he visited him and this and that. So, but he said, from what he said is that, and the explanation of Sheikh Muhammad ibn Ali ibn Adam, Dakhiratul Uqba fi Sharh al-Mujtaba, is exactly the same way of Fathul Bari of Hafiz ibn Hajar, rahimahullah. And one soul is confident to most of his choices of hadith and of fiqh, because it adheres the dalil, the evidence. And I advise all the students of knowledge to get this book, to have this book with them. And he said, and I used to write, to read Sunan al-Nisa'i, and I see the very, very precise issues of isnad and the difference of narrators in some hadith, and the al-Nisa'i had listed them in a very long breed, as they say. And he said, and I always say, the book of al-Nisa'i needs someone to explain it, but who can do that? Who can do all this to take these narrations and dismantle it in every narration and speak about it? Then he said, I asked Allah that he reward al-Imam al-Nisa'i and Shaykh Mohamed Adam khayran. And alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. When I finished writing this, he said, I wanted to write katabahu al-shaykhu muqbil. But he was very, very intelligent, very clever. He just noticed my hand position and he recognized that I'm going to say al-shaykh al-allama al-muhaddith. He knew that I'm going to write that. And I was sitting on the chair by his bed in the hospital, and he was in the lying down on the bed of the hospital. So he jumped in a very fast movement and he grabbed the notebook from me, the yellow bag, and he said, la, 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 meaning I'm not allowing you to write what you want to write. And then he only wrote, as you can't see it here, because what we did is that we later on put it in the computer, but we took the part where the Sheikh stamped and put it here. And here, as you see here, he wrote with his hand, Muqbil ibn Hadi al-Wadi'i. This shows that how clever the Sheikh was, rahimahullah. From also the things that I remember, benefits from the Sheikh used to memorize a lot of poems, and like Alfiyat al-Suyuti, Alfiyat ibn Malik, Alfiyat al-Iraqi, plus his own poems. He has Alfiyat. He has Alfiya in the Ilal of Hadith. He has Alfiya in Usul al-Fiqh, Alfiya in Aqidah, Alfiya in Muqaddim al-Tafsir of Sheikh Ibn Taymiyyah, Alfiya in many, many Alfiya, other than the books, And he wrote the, as you know, he wrote the He wrote the book Al-Bahr al-Muhit al-Thajjaj, Al-Bahr al-Muhit al-Thajjaj, the Sharh of Muslim al-Hajjaj. And also the Muqaddima. He explained the Muqaddima of Sheikh Imam al-Nawawi, Qurrat Ayn al-Muhtaj, the Sharh Muqaddima of Muslim al-Hajjaj. Sorry, the Muqaddima of Imam Muslim. And the Muqaddima is very, very important, Ikhwa. Don't think that the Muqaddima is only, the Muqaddima is the key, for understanding the book, for understanding the book. So, Shaykh Rahimahullah Ta'ala, Subhanallah, was Zahid. He didn't look for dunya. He used to, eat whatever, sleep whatever, wear whatever. He doesn't look for dunya. But all what he looks for is serving this knowledge, especially the knowledge of hadith. And that's why he always called himself Khuwaydimu al-Hadithi fi Makkah al-Mukarram. Fi Makkah. Naam. Khuwaydimu al-Hadithi. He always يعني say that. خويدم الحديث. خويدم العلم. Sometimes خويدم العلم. So the Sheikh يعني رحمه الله تعالى was يعني a model of the real scholar, and he was يعني as I used to read سير أعلام النبلاء, and يعني I used to have a habit before sleeping, I used to read from سير أعلام النبلاء and sometimes from البداية والنهاية. And I used to look to the seer of these scholars and I say, SubhanAllah, I can't see something like that today. Is this real? Until I saw number of shaykh, alhamdulillah, Shaykh Ibn Baz, Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen, Shaykh Albani, Shaykh Muqbil, Shaykh Muhammad Adam, Shaykh Muhammad Tayyib, Shinqiti in Mecca. Yani, SubhanAllah, I saw something really wondering, you know. So the Shaykh wrote many books, as you can go through, inshallah. The main ones is Sahih Muslim, Sunan Nisa'i, Masharik al-Anwar al-Bahaji, Sunan Ibn Majah. He had other books like Ithaf al-Talib al-Ahwad, Sharh Jami' al-Tirmidhi. He didn't finish it, but he worked on it. In Sunan al-Tirmidhi. Also, he had Alfiya, yani more than 1,000 line of poem in Aqidah called Ad-Durra al-Mudiyya fi Nazmi Tawhidi Rabb al-Bariyya. He had also Al-Jarh al-Jawhar al-Nafis fi Nazmi Asma' wa Maratib Man Urifu bil-Tadlis, Ma'ru al-Mawsufina bil-Tadlis. This is in about the Mudallisin, like that. Anyway, the books are so many, and the time is yani, past 1 hour. I don't want to take much time. Still, we have a lot to say about the Sheikh. But, ya ikhwa, yani, look at that. The Sheikh didn't want except to stay in Mecca. In this long time, he didn't go to his land except one in the early, very beginning when he came first. After that, he even doesn't go out of, yani, I asked him one time, I said, "Ya Sheikh, why don't you go with me? Because they go, yani, different places of the world to give da'wah. You go with me, I prepare everything." He said, "Ya Muhammad, I don't go out of Mecca, maybe Medina." He never goes to Jeddah. He has a brother in Jeddah, but he doesn't go. Just Medina and Medina, very, very few times he goes to Medina, and then he goes to Sheikh Abbad. And he visits Sheikh Abbad, and Sheikh Abbad used always to welcome him. And Sheikh Abbad was asked, "Why don't you?" Sheikh Abbad explained Alfiyat al-Suyuti in the Masjid al-Nabawi. And someone suggested that it is to be published. He said, "No, more than enough is what Sheikh Muhammad Adam has done in explaining and publishing Sharh Alfiyat al-Suyuti." Sheikh Albani, when he saw Sunan Nisa'i, he said that it's I never thought that any Salafi scholar would do this, but now Muhammad Adam is doing this. Anyway, ikhwa, the benefits are so many, but the major or the greatest benefit we get is try always to benefit from the ulama if they are available at your area. Don't try to ignore them. Try to get from them. Come close to them. Stick to the kibar. Kibar in age. Kibar in knowledge. This is, yahi, even if they have some mistakes, no one is perfect but Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. With you around the sheikh, scholar, you correct. I tell you, and last thing. I remember a young man came to Sheikh Muhammad Adam. I don't remember about this. Let me begin with where it began with me. Sheikh Adam called me one day. He said, "Ya Muhammad, come, rescue me." I said, "What, Sheikh?" He said, "I hear that Sheikh Rabi' is very angry of me." I said, "Why, Sheikh?" He said, I don't know. They say that a young student came and asked me about Jarh al-Ta'dil. Sheikh is too busy with Jarh al-Ta'dil of Ruah, narrators. He doesn't know about these things. Wallahi, Ikhwa, he doesn't know. You think that he's someone living in the very ancient era. So he doesn't know about this. Then that young man went to Sheikh Rabi' and said to him that Sheikh Adam said no Jarh al-Ta'dil. Now Sheikh Rabi' is Imam of Jarh al-Ta'dil of today. But he is talking about Jarh al-Ta'dil of the du'at today, the jama'at, which is needed and necessary. And impossible that Sheikh Adam say, no, don't. Lana, Sheikh Adam was one of those who suffered from jama'at tabliq, as I'm going to tell you now. So the Sheikh said that. I said, okay, Sheikh, let me see how I can do. I called Sheikh Ali Tuwajri, because he used to come to Mecca for Umrah. So I said, when you coming, let me know, because we need to go visit Sheikh Rabi' together. He said, okay. He came and he called me. I grabbed the book, Sunan Nasa'i, 12 values that time. And I went to Sheikh Rabi' with a letter on it from me to Sheikh Rabi', introducing my Sheikh and his works and like that. Before that, me and the students who used to go with me from Jeddah to Mecca, we used to, as I said in the beginning, we used to come to Ri' Baksh or Dar al Hadith, stop our car, go walking to the Haram, pray Maghrib, return. And then Isha the same. When we used to leave after Isha, we usually meet Sheikh Rabi' by the hospital of Ajiyad. We used to meet him there, and he used to ask, how are you? Where are you going? This. And we say to him. Then he says, okay, give salam to Sheikh Adam, which is good, alhamdulillah, that's very good. But what happens is, when we used to do that, after some time, we started seeing that the Sheikh doesn't ask where are you going, doesn't say anything. Then Sheikh Adam called me, then I put this, linked this to that, I knew that it affected. And Sheikh Rabi' is human. Normally, if someone comes to say to him like that, of course he will be very cautious. So I went with Sheikh Ali Tuwajir to Sheikh Rabi'a's house. We visited him, salam this, because Sheikh Rabi'a, he knows me, but he knows Sheikh Ali very well, because Sheikh Ali is a doctor in the Islamic University, and Sheikh Rabi'a used to be the head of the Sunnah faculty there. I gave him the book and we left. Because I used to attend the classes of Sheikh Rabi' in his house in Al-Awali in Mecca. I used to teach for Tawheed, Kitab al-Tawheed, and then he started teaching not Kitab al-Tawheed, Kitab Fath al-Majid, explanation of Tawheed, and then Sharia. So, but I kept seeing the book remain as is. This is not the habit of Sheikh Rabi'. Sheikh Rabi', subhanAllah, reads all the books in his library. He takes at least an idea about. But this left as is in the box and the dust accumulated, was wondering. Then I told Sheikh Mohamed Adam, okay, it was Ramadan, end of Ramadan. I said, Sheikh, second day of Shawwal, I'm going to come to you, me and two brothers, and we're going to take you, go visit Sheikh Rabi'. He said, okay. We prayed Asr from Jeddah. We went to Mecca, took the Sheikh from Hayy al-Nuzha. He used to live there. Then we went to Al-Awali. That was right after Maghrib. On the way, we prayed Maghrib, and we reached there. We knocked the door. The Sheikh used to have his villa, and he has a yard, which was covered with gravels. And he had a carpet over the gravels, and he was sitting alone. SubhanAllah. We came and said, Sheikh, this is Sheikh Muhammad Adam. Oh, mashallah, welcome. We talked a little bit. Then Isha came near, He said, yalla, ya akhwan, I need to go to Haram to pray Isha. We said, yeah, Sheikh, you go with us. He said, no, I go in my car with my driver. I tried with him. Then we said, yeah, Sheikh, you come, you and Sheikh Adam with me, and the two brothers go with the driver until the Haram, and there, if you want to leave us, you can leave us. He agreed. we went. On the way from his house to Al-Haram, it takes about nearly 15, 20 minutes. They were talking. Sheikh Rabi' was talking about Jama'atul Ikhwan Muslimin and how they damaged the da'wah. Sheikh Adam was talking about Jama'at Tabligh in his land, Ethiopia, because the communists there do not allow political parties, you know. But the Tablighis, they spread like the cancer everywhere. So, and even I remember that Sheikh Rabi' said, I talk to you about Ikhwan Muslimin, you talk about Tabligh. Sheikh doesn't know yani, the Ikhwan Muslimin at that time. But later, Sheikh knew about all of them. And he started warning. And I remember when the Sheikh Adam was sick and they booked him to go to Egypt to do kind of an operation or treatment. And he was told that number of Ikhwan Muslimin are waiting for him to come to visit him. The Sheikh canceled, as the brother told us, who was from Egypt, and he was going to go with him. He prepared everything. And he told him that some of the students from Ikhwan Muslimin, they want to come and see you. The Sheikh canceled the whole journey of treatment. He said, no, I don't want to see them. I don't want them to see me. I don't want to see them. Subhanallah. He was very strict because these people against the Sunnah. Impossible Sheikh Mohammed Adam will accept anybody against the Sunnah. They are against the Sunnah. They accept it or they're not. They say it or they're not. As Sheikh Albani said, that they are always yani, not on the side of the Sunnah. You know? So we went to Sheikh Rabi'. Alhamdulillah, that diluted the yani, problem. When we returned, yani that time, Sheikh, yani alhamdulillah, both of them were yani happy. So we returned in the same car to the Sheikh Rabi'a's house. Then Sheikh Muhammad al-Banna called and he wanted Sheikh Rabi'a to come. And we knew that Sheikh Adam and us there, he said, you all come. We went all together to the house of Sheikh Adam, who at that time called Maghrawi, who came to Mecca for some reason. Muhammad al-Maghrawi from Morocco, who had yani, a problem in yani, some issues of you know the manhaj. And he, Sheikh Muhammad al-Banna, gathered them all. Didn't work that yani, to correct Maghrawi. He stood in his own way. We had dinner in the Sheikh's house and it was good gathering between the three sheikh, Sheikh Muhammad al-Banna, Sheikh Muhammad Adam, and Sheikh Rabi', Hafidhahullah, Sheikh Rabi', Rahimahullah, Sheikh Muhammad al-Banna, Sheikh Muhammad Adam. After that, alhamdulillah, everything went nice. Sheikh Rabi' praised Sheikh Muhammad Adam and his work, his books. Alhamdulillah. This is, ya ikhwa, a lesson for us. Stay close to the ulama. If there is any type of fitna like that happening, try to reconcile between the ulama. This is our security on earth, ya ikhwa. These are the inheritors of Rasulullah, ya ikhwa. These are the candles and the spotlight of the dunya. Work hard to be with them and to support them and defend them. May Allah preserve those who are still alive of them. May Allah Ta'ala shower the graves of those who passed away with his mercy and put light in their graves, spread wide, and make us to be with them in the Firdaus al-A'la on the Day of Resurrection. Here we need to stop ending this session, which I never wish to end, but I got tired and you guys are busy. May Allah Ta'ala benefit us of what we hear. If I have shortened of any sight or feel, may Allah forgive me on behalf of my Shaykh, and may Allah forgive me. And I ask you also to forgive me if I did not present the talk very well, and I did not present or I did not give you enough benefits that you spare time for me. Barakallahu fikum. Jazakumullahu khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Ahsanallahu ilayk shaykhana wa jazakumullahu khair. Barakallahu fikum. Jazakallahu khair shaykhana.
Amin. Amin wa iyaakum.
MashaAllah. We really benefited from the story. Alhamdulillah, there was tamarat adida. A lot of benefits from that. الله خيرا شيخنا. ممكن ناخذ بعض الاسئله؟ اعرف انك يعني قليلا ناخذ
اليوم. اليوم يعني I had four lectures.
سبحان الله شيخ. لا
يعني even I missed Isha because the lecture before this was the same in Arabic.
الله
so I went into it and I didn't realize that Isha came. Isha finished. سبحان الله.
تفضل. طيب شيخ لو ناخذ بعض ان شاء الله لا نطيل ان شاء الله تعالى. طيب. طيب شيخنا السؤال الأول. So the first question. Someone's asking and they're saying, are any scholars trustworthy to take knowledge from in South Africa, or students of knowledge we could take knowledge from? There is a need for them in South Africa.
Wallahi, I never visited South Africa. I've been invited, but I really don't know any scholars in South Africa. I'm sure inshallah there are, because there are graduates from Medina and Umm al Qura and Imam from South Africa. I'm really not sure. I have no names in mind right now, but I'm sure that there are alhamdulillah, there is no land which yani is free from the scholars of Salafiyya. Alhamdulillah, in every land you can see, alhamdulillah, Salafiyya.
Barakallahu fiik, Shaykhana. Another question here. Where's the best place we can get Shaykh's Sharh of Sunan al-Nasa'i?
If you mean best place, yani as a country, I think it's Saudi, because it's published and printed here in Saudi. It used to be Dar al-Boom. Now it's Dar al-Mi'raj al-Duwaliyya lil-Nashr. Dar al-Mi'raj al-Duwaliyya lil-Nashr, they are the ones yani publishing it, and Dar al-Burum. But here in Saudi you can find it yani in almost yani many bookstores.
Barakallahu fiik, Sheikh. Another question here.
I suggest, inshallah. Let me first of all, I will contact the son of the Sheikh, because the Sheikh left some editions, and I think they need to sell so they can have their own livings. Not as his library, but he has some of these to be sold. Let me contact his son. If they still have some, and whoever wants, contact me and tell me what you want, and I'll ask if they have, or if not, then I will inshallah ask some bookstores here and try to connect you with them and see inshallah.
Barakallahu fi Sheikh. I think we'll take two last questions, Sheikh now. Mumkin?
Fadal.
طيب, we've got an important question here, mashallah. Any advice on raising children well?
Yeah, there are lots of advices to in regard to raising children well these days. My brothers and sisters, don't worry if your child doesn't know how to earn money, but worry about your child knows how to earn hasanat, how to be pious. Don't worry about your child going to schools or not, but worry about him going to circles of knowledge in circles of Quran and Hadith, and especially with Salafis and with trustworthy people. Some of our brothers are hoping to make their children study Islamically So they put them in schools, which is Ikhwanis or Shia or Dibandis or Railways. Now that's wrong, akhi. That's wrong. Yani, try to teach your child upon the Salaf way. If you don't find an institute and you can move from where you are to places, let me name some places for you. If you go, for example, Somaliland, if you go Somalia, if you go, I say Somaliland because it is settled and safe, no fighting, nothing there. Alhamdulillah, Somalia now is quiet, alhamdulillah. But there are lots of schools there. If you go to Gambia, Gambia is a small place, but very wonderful. They have a lot of institutes. They have Islamic University, which is established by some doctors from graduated from Medina with the assistance of Sheikh Dr. Abdulrazzaq Al-Abbad. There are some other places in the world where you can take yourself and your children and go there, learn your deen. Okay, but when you go, you need to make sure that you are not going to the hand of Sufis, of Ash'aris, of you have to go to a proper place. Now, and when you decide, inshallah, if you need, you contact me. We can tell you, advise you of some places where you choose, inshallah, the country, and we suggest you the places. Wallahu a'lam.
Barakallahu feekum, Shaykhana. We take the last question. I've got one related to the biography, and I've got one not.
None, brother.
I'm kind of stuck on which one to take. Should we take the one?
Take them both and be last.
Taib. So the one related to the biography, how many times did Sheikh Muqbil meet with Sheikh Mohammed Adam?
Only one time. Only that time when we met. And then, I forgot to mention that, when Sheikh Muqbil passed away, Sheikh Adam called me and said, if you can come, we go janaza. I drove at night because it was after Fajr. So we went to the Haram and prayed janaza, and then we went to the janaza. And subhanAllah, while we were in the graveyard by the grave, we noticed that our Imam in Masjid al-Haram, Dr. Saleh bin Hamid, was himself there by the grave of Sheikh Muqbil. Rahimahullah. And I forgot to say also something. Sheikh Abdurrahman al-Sidis, whenever he meets, Sheikh Abdurrahman al-Sidis, subhanAllah, was a great support. And before him, Sheikh Mohammed Sibayr, the former president of the Masjid al-Haram, before Sidis. Sheikh Sibayr and Sidis, they used to respect him highly, as well as Sheikh Salah bin Hamid. Sheikh Sidis, whenever he meets him, he says to him, like Imam Muslim used to say when he used to see his Sheikh Imam al-Bukhari, give him big names to the speaker, but it's not big to the one who is said about him, this is something I just remember to say. But anyway, he met him, to my knowledge, that time only in the hospital. Because after that, the Sheikh went very ill and he was taken to Germany. The visit was between the time Sheikh went to America and returned, and he was taken to Germany after that. And then he came back and he died in Jeddah. But as I remember, he met him that time when we visited him in the hospital, and then we, Sheikh and I, attended the janaza of Sheikh Muqbil rahimahullah.
Sheikh Ana, barakallahu fik. Akhir sual, last question. How can one make hijrah without money? Is it tawakkul to just book a ticket or go, or do you stay and save money?
It depends. If you are from Muslim land originally, like if you are from Pakistan, from India, from any Muslim land, it doesn't make big difference. And you can go there, you still have family. But if you don't have family, no, you need to make some money. This dunya today is different, not like it before. You go there and then you build a tent or yani, a small house from mud. That, today, it's not like that. Today, you have to buy the land. You have to build it with yani, lots of money. You have, so if you intend to migrate and you start working hard to save money for that, Allah will make it easy for you and will yani, make you earn enough to go. And believe me, I saw many migrants in, for example, in Gambia. In Gambia, I saw many from America, many from England. And mashallah, yani they are living because the style of life there is different from it than the West. It's cheap, it's basic. You know, you can live, you still can live. And if you have a skill, then you can do. You can do your own yani, work, your own business there, which doesn't take much time of yours, yani, and you can do your livings. But yani, my brothers, wallahi akhi, if you go even to just eat yani bread with yani, the Gambians, I remembered now something. In Ramadan, we give some yani money for iftar in African countries, and I'm talking about Gambia in particular. What do they serve? Dates, some dates, and bread and tea. They dip the bread in the tea and they eat it. Alhamdulillah, they are stronger than me. I eat meat, I eat chicken, I eat rice. They are stronger than me because yani, they are happy with what Allah Ta'ala gave them. And alhamdulillah, they are living. They are living. So my brothers and sisters, do not make yani money struggle. La, you go and Allah is the sustainer. Allah is the sustainer, the provider, who provides you in England can provide you more and more outside England. But you need to be yani sincere and honest with Allah and do the move. But if you find that yani it's yani not possible, then may Allah Ta'ala, you keep asking Allah, Allah will find your way.
بارك الله فيك شيخنا وجزاكم الله خير كانت ترجمة رائعة جدا
الله يحفظك
الله إليك شيخنا I see the happiness of memories on your face شيخ بارك الله فيك can only imagine how it was
والله يا أخي it is
أسمى ساكين
لا ما شاء الله جزاكم الله خير for being the cause يعني to spread the خير to the people الله تعالى put that in your records And also those who attended, may Allah Ta'ala shower them with mercy and increase them in knowledge and iman. Naam, barakallahu feekum. Wa sallallahu ala nabina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Alaikum assalam. Just for the listeners, to let you know, the Sheikh has a website, Sheikh Mohamed Maliki has a website. It's called Ilm for All. I'll put it on the chat, inshallah ta'ala, but you can visit the Sheikh's website, get a bit to know about the Sheikh and the other mashaykh they took from. Sheikh Adam in Ethiopia has his own website as well. You can find that, inshallah ta'ala, online. It shouldn't be hard to find. Barakallahu feekum. There you have it. Till the next lesson, inshallah ta'ala, that we have for Sheikh Mohamed al-Maliki. He, alhamdulillah, gives lessons here on al-Ihtisam bi-Sunnah. Every Tuesday and Wednesday. Tuesdays we do Juz Amma Tafsir, on which we are now towards the end of Surah Abasa. And we do Usul Thalatha on Wednesdays. He's actually on the final stages of Usul Thalatha. So we kind of finished that book. Hopefully we get another Aqidah book from him. But stay tuned on our social media. Wallahu ta'ala wa sallallahu wa sallam ala nabina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.